Okay, good evening and happy holidays to you. Welcome to the Edgar Cayce On series, this time on pets, angels, and elementals. I am going to take the time this evening to be able to describe what each of those things are, not in great depth, but enough to be able to whet your interest and appetite on it. As always, do like to start with a disclaimer, not that you folks haven't heard it before, but since these are videos are broadcast on YouTube, a lot of people this is the first time they've ever seen one of these. We make sure that they know that the presentation you're getting tonight is as I interpret the Edgar Cayce readings and other materials that you're about to hear tonight. It's not saying this is exactly how Edgar Cayce meant it to be. And I invite, as it says on here, all of you to ask me for the information and materials that I put this together with, and I will be able to give that to you so that you can do your further study and make up your own mind. All right, so you were going to get an awful lot of these. Well, I don't know if you know what the term is. It's called a GIF, G-I-F is the extension, and that's these kind of pictures that change around like this. And I want to be able to start with, what is the difference between humans and the rest of the animal kingdom? The answer to this actually surprised me. I mean, as long as I've been studying the Cayce readings, it went further into detail than I had ever come into before in answer to that. So our first reading here, and of course I'm going to give you a few things so that you'll understand it. Whenever you see three asterisks like that, it means I'm still giving you a direct quote from the readings, but I cut out some of the information between where this ends and this picks up. So it's still a quote, but it'll take you a while to put that together. You have the reading number right here that says how you would be able to find it in the Cayce readings, the date the reading was given, and I give the actual person or source in this case. First time I've been doing this, that I'll actually give you the name or the source of of that reading. In this case, the ASFG stands for a Search for God readings. All of the 262 readings go into that book that we do small group work for the Edgar Cayce study groups. So, starting with the 26280 up here at the top, it says, what is known as the group mind, or that of the plant kingdom, the mineral kingdom, and the animal kingdom or group, returns as its destiny to the creative force, which is its author, its maker. For mind is the dividing line between that which is human, that which is man, and that which is animal, or of that division of a group soul or consciousness. Now, one reason why we like to be able to show you this is so that you have the source material, and then I can kind of give you an idea of, when I read this, what do I make out of it? Because the syntax of the Cayce readings is kind of a learned process to be able to go through. So, as I look at this, it appears to me that our conscious minds are somewhat pre-programmed for things, you know, that the animal or human body or animals in general go through, like fight or flight, self-preservation, continuing of the species, and so on. So those are the things that are like imprinted into the mind of a corporeal or a physical body. As eternal beings, we have a whole different mind that is programmed differently. For instance, we can't be permanently harmed, so we have to have a different perspective. How can you have to worry about fight or flight if you know that you can't, you know, if somebody can't hack your arm off or something like that? It's a whole different way of looking at things. If you know you're an eternal being and can't be killed, you're not worried about the preservation of the species. It's a different mind that we have for the soul mind than we have when we're in physical form. So when we are in human form, the thoughts of our soul minds are blended with the thoughts of the body's desires to go along with our soul's desires at the same time. And so if you're wondering why we have this little good angel on one shoulder and a bad angel on the other shoulder, you know, that are constantly fighting back and forth, this will give you a little bit of an indication as to why that would happen. So an animal's thinking comes from the same being that it refers to up here as a group mind. So it comes from a single being or a group mind that manifests as all of nature. This is what I really learned for the first time. I had known in the Cayce material that the animal kingdom was of a group mind or a group soul, just one entity that manifested as all the different types of animal life. But it also, according to this, is apparently not just animal life, but plant or vegetation life, as well as the mineral kingdom, are all controlled by this one mind that we might call Mother Nature. So there's one group mind that is in charge, if you will, of manifesting in the universe all of the things that we would call the animal, plant, or mineral kingdoms. So now you're seeing what I would, this is a depiction of the Big Bang, if you will. So when God said in the Bible, "Let there be light," as in creating a manifest universe, this is what allowed souls to separate cause and effect. And that's because of linear time. You've heard that joke that says, you know, time is God's way of keeping everything from happening to us at once. And it's funny. I mean, it's, you know, kind of a play on words, but it's also very true. If you don't have a linear order to things that happen to you, you don't realize that when you treat somebody else badly, they treat you badly in return. Or when you do something wrong to somebody else, something wrong happens to you, as we define that word. So it is very good to have linear time to be able to see what is the effect of the causes that we put into motion. And that happened as a result of having a manifest universe as opposed to everything being like our dreams. You know, dreams don't seem to be all that coordinated or organized. Well, guess what? If you don't have any time or space putting that in sequential order for you, it isn't all that easy to keep it straight. So, you know, clearly the universe is not just here to help us find our way back to God, but God actually has allocated the resources of the universe so that, just like the prodigal son, we will all return to him according to our free will choices. So the earth started out, let's say, as an art project. You know, the God was trying to create this beautiful work of art with all of the souls working with him on that. And then other souls came in with some selfish intent. And then it kind of became a, it was retasked to become like a reform school. So here we are on time out in our reform school, learning how to play well with others. So it didn't start out that way, but we have all of the resources of the manifest universe working with us souls who have made selfish choices to find our way back to God, just like the story of the prodigal son. So a longer reading right here, and in this case it says 281.54, which is the series of prayer group readings that it was the people that were around Edgar Cayce that decided we have an emphasis or a work to do in prayer back in the 1941. So the seven is referring to the paragraph, and it starts with a question. Now remember, this is a question, but it's actually being worded in a way that says, I am making a statement, is this true or false, is if you were to read more context to it. God made the mineral, vegetable, and animal kingdoms. Then out of these, he made man and breathed into him the breath of life. Adam, who at that period was devoid of any of the spiritualized of the physical body, a stronger urge to revert to physical desires. Now, this is not saying this is true. This is the question saying, is this true? This is Cayce's answer. In reference to this, yes and no. Consider that whether it is mineral, vegetable, or animal, these are spiritual lies in that ability of using, doing, being all that the Creator had given them to do. Hence, man was given that which is not a part of mineral, vegetable, or animal kingdoms, though man, by man, is considered of the animal kingdom. Will, with the environmental forces and the spiritual negative in the serpent, acceded to desire to become and to experience in that kingdom of influence. This brought the acceptance by man's own will. A lot of information in there, but what I get an indication from this that the animal, vegetable, mineral kingdom all naturally respond in harmony to the rest of God's creation. It is not an effort. It is not even hardly a choice for them to respond in harmony. They just do so. Now, we souls, on the other hand, having free will to make choices that say God would not, we're different. So when, God in the Bible, it says that we were instructed to subdue the earth. It was very much like I was talking about, that the earth has been retasked to, all of the resources on the earth have been retasked to aid in our return to God's perfect ways. So we have the ability to lead those same sources, and we can do that to our weal or woe. In other words, we can use, the atom to create power that'll give light and heat and everything to everybody, or you can create them a nuclear bomb with it. All right, so we have the ability to subdue the earth, and we can do so that will either happen in a good way or a bad way, and it's up to us to make that happen. So this is, I like this slide because it's kind of what I imagine it would be like to be a soul who just arrived in this solar system. Imagine that you're a soul and you don't really have arms and legs, but you see the sun in the center with the planets going around it, and you go, I want to be able to center my consciousness in this solar system, and then I'm going to start discerning all the details about it. So I just put myself in the very center of it all and watch all these planets going around, and I start getting into the details of what happens on each planet. Now, of course, the third planet out there is Earth, and it held so much life, it became of particular interest to us. So like you've seen those cartoons of Casper the Friendly Ghost, where he goes ahead and inserts himself, the ghost character can animate like a broom or a chair or something like that, or Gumby going into a book, you know, and seeing the story in there. We inserted our consciousness into the solar system as we began to focus on the details in Earth. So in doing so, we begin to project our minds into the animal, vegetable, mineral kingdoms in order to be able to experience 3D in outside of being an observer. Now we're actually participating as we take on the mind of a bird, or we take on the mind of what it's like to be a plant, or even just a vein of gold in the ground or something like that. We could experience what the vibratory patterns and thoughts are of each of those creatures. So that's kind of what I'm trying to convey here with the picture. Now, before we blocked our minds from God's creative power, we were able, like the GIF is showing here, we were able to create any life form that we wanted. Now, this isn't something that Cayce said, but my own personal take is God did not create roaches. God didn't create mosquitoes. There are a number of things that I think were just our great ideas. And it's not hard to be able to tell the difference between them. And we have the ability to create any life form we wanted. And even after we'd done that, at least initially, we could also change those life forms at will, until we forgot how. Because the problem is that once you project your consciousness into a particular life form, you start to take on those mindful characteristics. Remember how I said the desires of the physical body start to get blended with our spiritual mind, and all of a sudden we forget who we are. I mean, how many people are walking around on the earth today that would swear this is all that consists of us? And if this body dies, we're done. I mean, there's a vast number of people who feel that way, even if we don't in this room. Well, according to Cayce's readings, many of the ancient myths, where you would think of the fantastic beasts that, that had their basis in reality, like the Medusa, Minotaurs, and things like that, those incredible beasts were just by our own creation, and they had no godly reason for being on the earth other than we used or misused our abilities to be able to create such things. So it actually, back then, we could get entrapped in these forms, like this one in particular, right here, going down into a mosquito from that god-awful whatever it is there. It's not even quite a centaur there in the beginning. But it is only once the body of Adam, the human body, appeared that we finally got on the right track to be able to reincarnate only as humans. So if you've heard the other part, it's a Hindu belief as far as transmigration, which allows you to reincarnate not only in human form, but also in other forms as well that are not human. And that is not one of the things that the Cayce readings say is accurate anymore. But it has been accurate since Adam came into being, and there was the perfect form of the human body in order to give us the best opportunity for spiritual growth here on the earth. I'll go into that a little bit more here in a minute. So here we are with another reading. This particular person, believe me, if you wanted to study the readings and this individual, Beatrice Say, look up 2072-8, because she had a personal relationship, especially in other lives, with Edgar Cayce, and to be able to see, you know, how they go back in time together is really quite interesting. But that's not the focus of what we are here. So I'll just go with the reading start there, where it says, as has been indicated, in that particular experience, there were still those who were physically entangled in the animal kingdom with appendages, with cloven hooves, with four legs, with portions of trees, with tails, with scales, with those various things thought or evil had so indulged in as to separate the purpose of God's creation of man, not as animals, but as man. So I wanted to show you how what I've been talking about before, where we would project our consciousness into three dimensions and create these monstrosities, if you will, out of our own creative abilities, were not in harmony with God's creation, but it was our choice to do so, and that's what we do. There is one lucky thing. As we really start to depart in consciousness from God, we also forget how to access God's power. So we can no longer mess with anybody outside of the solar system. We've lowered our consciousness to the point where we just don't play well with each other instead of other galaxies. Thank God. All right? So this is how we first became entrapped in three dimensions on Earth and even entwined with the animal kingdom, because we would create bodies that had all of these things, including portions of trees, let alone tails and scales and all the rest of that up there. So the animal kingdom has some, but not all, of the glands of the endocrine system in the body. You may have heard of them as the seven spiritual centers or the seven chakras. And if you were to compare our endocrine system with the other animals, they all have glands of the endocrine system within them, but to be able to have them in the same order and importance to bodily functions as we do within the human form is where there's a real difference, and why we reincarnate into human form every time. This body allows the soul to be able to plug perfectly if we will align ourselves with it. Somebody showed us how to do that. His name was Jesus. Jesus was able to perfectly manifest the Christ consciousness here on earth by making excellent use of the seven spiritual centers and making perfect choices throughout his life. So that's why we reincarnate as humans, so that our soul minds have all the control that we need and want over our bodies on the earth. And we are able to control or spiritualize the carnal or physical desires that the physical instinctual brain uses. Now we start getting into concepts of how do dogs, cats, other animals interact with us. Those individuals who had, through their sojourns in the earth as souls, pushed into matter as to become separate entities without the consideration of principle or the ability of self-control, might be compared to the domestic pets of today, as the present development of the horse, the mule, the dog, the cat. If you're making a monstrosity and you still have the connection with the divine, you probably think that's going to be a pretty smart individual. Well, that is the truth. They would be a relative to us, an omniscient person, even, when they're doing wrong things, if they still have that connection. But here's the thing. How many people think they get smarter when they drink too much alcohol? And so imagine that that's what a soul's doing. Goes, I'm going to go ahead and project my consciousness down in there, and I've got a hold of this. And guess what? Nothing changes when they do that. They still think they've got it under control, even when they don't. My gosh, I have the ability to sing and dance like nobody ever knew if I've had too much to drink. If I start singing country western music, don't let me drive. No, I can't. All right. So the monstrosities were not exactly bright because they had very little access to the spiritual mind. Essentially, think of taking this very bright soul and making it drunk, very drunk, so it doesn't have the connection with the divine consciousness out there. So here's a good example. Have you ever tried to trace a drawing, like you take your finger and you could make a five-pointed star? I mean, I can do that very easy all day long. Have you ever tried to look in a mirror only and do that? Trace the star that's right there. If you've never done it, it's a fascinating example because your mind works in the other direction. You're going, wait a minute, I come from this existence where there's no time and space, and yet now I have linear time and everything is working very different from what I'm used to. And it starts to feel, your hand starts going the wrong direction and nothing makes sense to you anymore. It's really an interesting experiment if you haven't done it. It seems easy. But from the soul's perspective, it should be easy to come and go as we please in and out of the various physical forms that we created until we forget how. So once we forget and we start to think of ourselves as only physical beings instead of a soul, suddenly we start to take on the mental characteristics of a horse, a mule, a dog, a cat, of what they're instinctually, how they're reacting is very much, there's another reading that'll come up here that'll start talking about how do we become stubborn as a mule or catty as a cat or something like that. You'll see it in a moment. So imagine, what does it look like when we start to impress our spiritual being into three dimensions? This was a nice drawing to be able to indicate that, saying, okay, you have all these atoms and molecules in three dimensions, and when we decide to go ahead and impress ourselves into three dimensions, all of a sudden they start to conform. I finally remembered to bring this thing. I almost never do. Have you ever seen one of these? All right, so imagine that each one of these little nails right here is indeed one of the molecules that we're seeing right here, and we decide to impress ourselves into it. See what I'm getting at? So you look on the other side of this thing, and you don't even see anything. You look on the back side of it, and you go, that's just air. Well, you look back, you know, around the edge of that, and you say, there's nothing there. Not true. Okay, this is what happens when we start to take our spiritual essence and impress it into three dimensions. It becomes very clear who we are. And so that it is very little difference with the animal kingdom. And you notice they animals tend to, and especially even young children, tend to get along a lot better than people who have got some years and have made their own suppositions about how life is supposed to go. So if our ethereal type souls are pushing ourselves into 3D, it seems like there's only a blank space behind that material curtain, if you will, but our spiritual substance is always going to show through. Now, what would it look like to have a soul entrapped in a dog's body, subject to the will of the higher life forms around it? You know, you're not a bright person at this point, and so you put yourself in a dog's brain, and you have a dog's desires, but let's say you can still communicate.
Food. You know, I just couldn't stop thinking about it.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I went to the fridge, and I opened up the meat drawer. You know what the meat drawer is, right?
Yeah. What was in there?
Well, I'll tell you what was in there. You know that bacon that's like maple? It's got maple flavor.
The maple kind, yeah.
Yeah, so...
Yeah?
I took that out, and I thought...
Yeah?
I know who would like that. Me! So I ate it.
Oh! No! You kidding me?
Nope. Not kidding. You know, I also noticed there was some beef in there. Yeah, you know, steak, you know, juicy. Well, I ate that too. But I went back to the fridge just a few minutes ago, and I put something together really special. You're going to love this one. I took some chicken.
Yeah.
I put some cheese on it, and I... Covered it with what?
I
covered it with cat treats.
Yeah.
Then guess what?
What?
I gave it to the cat.
Oh, that's just so mean.
So the poor dog's kind of at the whim of the master in that case. That was beautifully done. And you can tell it's like, well, why are you treating me like this, et cetera, et cetera. And so you can see how our karmic interactions from one lifetime into the next, in which one person winds up being the boss and the other one the, you know, employee and so on, and, or the older and younger sibling and so on and so forth, tends to manifest this way. And this is what animals are subject to in terms of humans. All right, but I'm just trying to draw the line there. I'm going to cover dogs in detail here in a bit. So the next reading, has my soul entity experienced transmigration through minor plant and animal kingdoms? Now, the answer is, those kingdoms are of the universal soul consciousness. Each soul entity was created or began in the beginning with the Father. Not evolution as from the standpoint that there wasn't and then there was, but rather the evolution of the environs for the soul development of those who had wandered from the pathway. So it's talking about we were created perfect, but there was a soul development, that's a nice way of putting it, when we started to make selfish choices. Each one of us became even more unique with each new selfish choice that we made. And so there was a soul development, in a manner of speaking, in when we started to wander away from the path. So what this reading out of this is like us, our free-willed souls, the animal, vegetable, mineral group mind has always been and will always be. The concept of in any manifestation, there is going to be this entity, if you will, that is created to be able to handle any kind of manifestation of life in the animal, vegetable, mineral kingdom. So like the body, it manifests in various ways, skin, bones, organs, and so on, but it's all still part of the whole. But still, the physical forms of all nature had a beginning, so they too will also have an end, just like our physical bodies. The soul is eternal, but these physical bodies go away, and so does the physical form that the animal, vegetable, mineral kingdom group mind is in control of. Certainly with the Big Bang, right? When Big Bang goes out, comes back together, all that's over. All right, so that's an interesting way of being able to differentiate between the two, certainly from a free will standpoint. Now, and get into some interesting questions along the way. The question of what life was like on Earth before our free will soul's influence came in is an interesting one. For instance, did God or selfish souls invent the carnivore? You know, and that the Bible verse talks about the lion lying down with the lamb, and it makes you begin to feel like everybody was a vegetarian at one point. Well, if you go to the Cayce readings, the furthest back in time reference that I've read of a soul's incarnating or impelling themselves into three dimensions is 10 million years ago. Gave a reading to a woman who said, you could still see the drawings on a cave right here in the Pacific Southwest region from 10 million years ago if they could go into those caves and find the drawings even to this day. Well, that was 10 million years ago. Does anyone know when dinosaurs left the Earth for whatever reason? It's about 65 million years ago. So that's quite a gap between the two. Now, does this image look like a peaceful vegetarian to you? I mean, there's a lot more to what I'm saying than just, you know, the carnivore of a Tyrannosaurus Rex. But what I'm getting to is the cycle of life when it's seen from a spiritual perspective. It's actually harmonious rather than being out of accord with God's ways. How? Well, you know, I got slides to be able to help you with that. Does this look familiar to anybody? This is one of my favorite movies when I was 10. You go back and look at it now and you're going, really? But this person on the left is Donald Pleasance. He was the bad guy in this movie called Fantastic Voyage. Also had that wonderful actress Raquel Welch, who is so talented. So in 1966, the movie Fantastic Voyage, the theaters, and so this was some of the most incredible special effects anybody had seen up to that time. So this picture that you're seeing here is of this microscopic ship. They had to save some very important guy's life, and they had this technology to shrink this giant size, I mean a big, you know, ship that could hold 6-7 people, down into a tiny size and inject it into this person's circulatory system. So that's what you're seeing here. It's maneuvering through a blood vessel, and what you're seeing are various corpuscles floating along beside them out there. So you have red and white corpuscles. The color's not too good on that, but that's what you're seeing there. So I wanted to remind you of this movie and to kind of get this perspective to make the point that I want to about how the cycle of life works. Now, this is not from Fantastic Voyage, but it's a little easier to see the red, and you can see the white corpuscles, you know, down all throughout the red corpuscles there as well. Now, how many people saw that movie, by the way? I know you're all old enough. All right. So if you've seen the movie, do you remember how Donald Pleasance, the bad guy, died? He got eaten by white corpuscles. And the reason being is that the ship started to get bigger. It ran out of time and it started to get bigger. And the white corpuscles finally decided, hey, this is a threat to this body. There wasn't anger. There wasn't vengeance. The white corpuscles said, you are now a threat to my existence. And the animal mind, if you will, comes in and says, we need to deal with this right here and right now. So it got, you know, enveloped in white corpuscles and consumed. So had nothing to do with, you know, with the anger or vengeance that we typically do. It was in self-defense. You know, another way to look at this, so too do black holes crush stars and planets as they enter into their gravitational realms. They don't do it out of anger or vengeance or anything like that. You know, you could also say that suns go nova and destroy entire solar systems. And think of all the life that is killed rather dramatically, you know, in a case like that. And isn't the Big Bang like the beginning and ending of all us life in the universe, as we would look at? These are very violent, very, you know, catastrophic events that take place that are a normal part of the cycle of life as we know it out there. So it's really important when you're seeing something like this to start thinking of it not only on a microscopic scale like we have here, but on a macro scale as well. So when we think of the lion lying down with the lamb, can we see that as being more of a harmonious metaphor of cooperation rather than condemning what we would otherwise define as needless violence? Saying, you know, when the lion actually takes down the lamb, is that cooperation, just like you have white corpuscles that are making sure that the species survives because you eat? So it's one of the other things that the Bible says is, and Jesus was the one who said it, that no greater love is demonstrated than when one person gives up their life for another. So in fact, these catastrophic events can be seen as loving rather one another and being able to support and help one another rather than being part of that needless violence. Offer that as a different perspective from what we may have thought of in the past for that. Okay. Going on to another reading, and this one, I don't know how, if you follow the Cayce readings, this is definitely a name you'll know, Morton Blumenthal. He was the best financial supporter for many years of the Cayce work, and in fact, almost single-handedly built that hospital we use as a headquarters for the ARE out in Virginia Beach to this day. So, to Morton Blumenthal, he said, "We are one with the flowers of the field, the waves of the sea, the breath of the forest, with all mankind, yet different only in the absorption or method of acquisition of the power of the whole spirit. We are that spirit, not yet become equal to that spirit. This is all true." The three asterisks indicates there was a lot more to go there, but ended the paragraph with "this is all true." Now, if you take a look at what it's talking about here, I was especially interested in the absorption or method of acquisition of power of the whole spirit. We are able to absorb power ourselves when we go to sleep, right? In our dream state, and we have REM sleep, and the Cayce readings say that that is when the soul is able to step out of the body and be rejuvenated at that point. I'm not saying that animals don't do that as well, but I do think that animals do not need to meditate like humans do. I think that is one of the main things it's talking about as far as a different manner, a method of acquisition of power from the whole spirit. To be able to meditate is a whole different way that is available to a free-willed soul to replenish, to rejuvenate ourselves. And meditation is a wonderful thing in order to be able to commune, but let's face it, animals don't need it if they haven't messed up to begin with, right? You just naturally are availing yourself of the energy that you need. So, you know, if you look down at the hair in the shower floor drain or a fingernail you just cut off, we don't think of that as being part of our body. But, you know, logically, we know that's where it came from, right? So in the same way, despite our different manifestations on Earth, all life comes from God and is a part of us. It doesn't matter what we're looking at. I mean, I hate to make it so, you know, I don't know what word to use here, but if I say the chair, the carpet, the ceiling, as well as the humans, as well as the Christmas tree in the back, it is all part of us, knowing that we live and move and have our very being within the mind of God. So, you know, that's, I'm saying all of this to actually be encouraging rather than discouraging as far as anybody watching this, even though I say, well, the animals never really, you know, made poor choices. And yet I didn't hear anything about the, you know, a prodigal son having to do with animals, only with humans. But what a blessing when the prodigal son returned. You know, you kill the fatted calf, Once again, we're doing violence to animals in order to be able to sustain and celebrate ourselves, etc. By the way, I'll just do this as a side note. If you absolutely had to be a vegetarian, why was Jesus cooking a meal of fish and honey when he resurrected from the dead and met his disciples? You just have to look at that and say it is what the intention is, and that the cycle of life, of being able to have life give itself for life, and it's even being done by the Christ incarnate through Jesus, you have to say that there is an appropriate time to be able to do all of this. Besides that, who's to say that, you know, the plant kingdom doesn't also have a consciousness that we should be aware of? I mean, why are we just dissing the plants out there if it's okay to eat them and not the animals? I mean, where do you want to draw the line? Well, that's an interesting slide. Okay, what I was intending to show here is that, for instance, with this image over here to the side, it's real easy to discern that these boxes have very specific colors to them. And it's easy to go ahead and identify that these are very specific colors allocated to those circles right there. But in the other ones, it's more of a blend, isn't it? And I think this is an important concept to try to keep in mind. I know that I've talked to other people about, I go to do this Science of Mind or this other church over here that has a person with these psychic readings. It says that there's 49 levels or dimensions in this solar system that we have to attain to in order to be able to, and I'm like, whoa, stop. Even if that's true, it's not helpful to me to know what those 49 levels are. I'm having enough trouble just trying to treat others well, you know, let alone try to know what the 49 levels you were talking about are. So there's this blended concept I think really applies to everything. I'm going to talk about it here when it has to do with especially with angels or with what are called elementals, or like fairies and brownies and gnomes and things like that, that there is more of a blending instead of saying there is this and there's this and there's this and this. If you try to go in the direction of knowing what all 49 dimensions are or whatever they were talking about, you're really going to make your head spin. So if you get used to thinking of everything as kind of being a blend, I remember a good example of this in talking in a small group one time. I was talking about Cayce's take on the second coming, when Jesus would return. I had one of the people that was attending the group said, "And what date will that be?" I said, "Well, he didn't really give us this." And the best answer I really have for that is, what if I were to ask you, when did the Renaissance begin? Now, they stop for a second, and they're going, okay, I don't actually have a date. Wasn't it somewhere from here to here, like 1450 to 1500? I'm going, good, that's the idea. It is a blend. It didn't happen on this date. It more or less was like an evolution, a metamorphosis, going from this point to this point over a period of time. And it wasn't these very discrete steps of one going to the other. Maybe you can try to apply that after the fact, but if you're going through it at the time, the idea of trying to have these very discrete steps is not very helpful to us. The animal seeks only gratifying of self, the preservation of life, the satisfying of appetites. With infinity injected in same brought the many confused activities or thoughts that we know now as appetites. Yes, a dog may learn to smoke. Yes, a horse may learn to eat sugar. But these are not natural inclinations. Rather, man's influence upon these activities by association. By the way, this is, once again, is this woman who had personal interactions with Cayce, especially in young years between them. So animals are not confused by the limitations of time and space. They're very comfortable with satisfying the appetites of the body. It's only when you start injecting infinity into your thoughts, as we humans, coming from souls, do, that we wind up getting a little confused. Okay, so it only becomes a sin if an animal does some of the things that we teach them to be wrong. It only becomes a sin if they make or actually willfully choose to sin. I mean, if they make a sinful action only because they were told to by their master, or that was, you know, what they were trained to do over and over again, and they just do it from cause and effect, that's not willful disobedience. And it's certainly one of the things that I'm going to go into when I talk about the angels and the elementals as I get down the road here. So this is an interesting GIF in that I think it is helpful to understand when you see all, if you can pick out these words here that have to do with what parts of the brain. This is saying this has to do with sin, and there was one that has to do with excess and cloth and skull and flowing. And you see, these are all different types of thoughts, and it's indicating that there are different parts of the brain that are responsible for thinking these particular types of thoughts. Now, this is only indicative. This is not saying these are actually where in the brain these things are handled. But just as these specific parts of the brain handle those particular aspects of our thinking, so too do I think that the mind of God delegates the parts of running the manifest universe to maintain it all as we know it. I believe that there are hierarchies of angels. In case he speaks of those, I'll have to come up in a second. But we have seen that there is a group mind that's in charge of the animal, plant, and mineral manifestations that we see. So I want to now move on to take a look at how our pets, are manifested specifically within the animal kingdom, and what's the difference between, say, a feral pet and a domesticated one. So those are typical household pets that we have, domesticated pets. And anyone can tell the difference between, you know, a domesticated and a feral pet. If you've ever tried to go up and pet one. But you understand that really winds up being a learned behavior, and it truly is a matter of cooperation between the animal and yourself. Because if they're domesticated, they're going, if I learn that you're friendly, I can be friendly back. But if I'm feral and I haven't learned that yet, my best option in the universe is to protect myself, self-preservation of the species, fight or flight, whatever the best choice is, in order to be able to meet the animal instincts that I have been born with. So they can be trained to do something else, and we've been told to subdue the earth and domesticate, you know, whatever we want. Long reading again, but it's worth listening to. I don't know who this individual is in the whole scheme of Cayce's personal life, but the reading was interesting. Those individuals who had through their sojourns in the earth as souls pushed into matter as to become separate entities, without the consideration of principle or the ability of self-control, might be compared to the domestic pets of today, as the present development of the horse, the mule, the dog, the cat. This is not intended to indicate that there is transmigration or transmutation of the soul from animal to human. But the comparison is made as to trait, as to mind, and as to how those so domesticated in the present are dependent upon their masters. Hence the terms docile as a horse, as catty as a cat, as stubborn as a mule, and the like. Have you ever seen those pictures of how a pet's master can actually start to look like the pet themselves? Yeah, I think those are hilarious. But I also think that this is indicative of, like we say that we have this effect that, you know, a dog can learn to smoke, a horse can learn to eat sugar. We can also, if we open ourselves up to it, and I know if you're like Stephanie and I, you treat your pets like family. And you would, I think this is where owners and pets start to look alike, because you open yourself up to their influence, where you would wind up being, you know, as stubborn as a mule, as catty as a cat, and so on. You can wind up taking on their instinctual traits, just like they can take on the learned behaviors that we would teach them. So it's interesting that it can work in both directions, depending on how open we are to doing that. Anybody recognize this movie? From the movie that was done in, I don't know if it was in the 50s or the 60s, on Atlantis. It was not a good movie. That's probably why you haven't heard of it. But this particular scene in the movie was actually showing, demonstrating that they were aware, even in Hollywood, that they were messing with DNA back in those times to create monstrosities. And that this was kind of a feral minotaur, if you will, that was created, and what they are trying to do is subdue it so it will become a beast of burden. All right, that's what was going on in this case in the movie itself. All right, so and today we know that, gosh, there's been news recently about gene splicing. Weren't they trying to do away with AIDS in an Asian country or something like that by doing gene splicing and tweaking the DNA? Well, in Atlantean times, they had a big ethical question, and that was whether or not these things that oftentimes they were called automatons or monstrosities that they had genetically created, whether this has a soul or not. Think about that for a moment. You see this thing, you've created it, does it have a soul like all the other human beings out there? Now, the question gets a little more complicated because if it does have a soul, then did they have the right to make to make the being like you have pictured here sleep in a barn and do manual labor all day? If it has a soul, is that, you know, the highest and best use of that individual? And what it could come down to is a question of competence. You know, what's the mental ability of that particular being right there? Because here's one that'll mess us up. You take a child who is on the autism spectrum, and their potential is no greater than. And yet, why would we try to bring the greatest, you know, experience and have the greatest use and happiness in life for the autistic child if we wouldn't do it for this beast, if it's only a matter of how smart they are, if you want to bring it down to that? So it is an interesting question. It's, why should one species be treated differently from others? Now, I'm not trying to answer those questions here, but it is interesting to learn how far back in history we can go where we are wrestling with the same issues that we are confronted with today, because the technology is back in order to do that. My wife warned me that I have to let a couple of times because nobody will hear me. You can see, okay, we're eating fast food, we're doing homework, we're playing video games, we're taking selfies. Okay, so if you're like Stephanie and I, then your pets really are treated like family. And we are still mom and dad with the final say in what's allowed, you know, when you're raising your children, if you will. But we include them in whatever we do, wherever we can. And we even, for instance, instead of McDonald's, we'll choose to go to Arby's because our two puppy dogs really like Arby's. And we care about them, and that's how we relate to them, to the point where they really become like our humans, even though we don't think of them, you know, we no longer think of them as just being some dumb dog like, a person on the street would. All right, so here comes a question that starts to give us a deeper understanding of where our pets come from. In this case, the question was the soul consciousness of Peggy, who was the person's dog, present in this room, meaning that the dog was actually in the room, Cayce was giving the reading in their home, in any of my animals then in this past life? So in other words, this questioner, Lillian Zentgraf, had a past life in which she was aware that she had animals back then. It was wondering if the dog that she had in the current life, as Lillian Zentgraf, the dog's name was Peggy, was that dog with her back then? And the answer was just a simple yes, and then said, which one? The answer was, in the animals, in the home, or in the house. Now, and if you were to read more of this, and it was so long, I couldn't figure out how to edit it up. But I will tell you that what the reading would talk about is that she has been a great lover of animals, and that there were a number of animals, some of them were allowed in the house, and some of them weren't. All right, but she had a great love of animals. And so when she's trying to say, okay, I have Peggy this dog in which lifetime, and in one of my past lives, saying which one, in this case, it was kind of indicating, and what I get from this is that there is the ability of that group mind, that group soul, whatever you want to call it, to be able to relate to us in a couple of different ways. It could relate to us like, have you ever seen a flock of birds that just is amazing and moving around together in perfect order? They go back and forth, or bees or ants, you know, when they all work in this beautiful, harmonious way in working together as a group. And I think this is really what it's indicating, is that the concept that is manifesting as Peggy, this individual dog, is the same consciousness that was manifesting in all of the animals as a group, as a hive, as a colony, if you will, at the same time. So that, here's a good way. Cayce says that, God is not a personality or a consciousness as we understand it, but you can have a closer relationship with God than you can with your neighbor here on earth. All right. So it is. What I'm saying is what happens with this group mind, this group soul. We can have as close a relationship with it as we want, or we can be, you know, at arm's length if we want to. We can deal with it as if it were a hive or a colony, which is closer than it being a feral animal that you need to stay away from, but it's not as close as bringing this animal into your home and into your heart. So I think these things are all being indicated here. When you see what it's talking about with this dog, it's like the animals in the home or in the house. So it was closer to them, but not quite as close as maybe you would have with your children. So you can teach a dog to smoke. Sorry, dog. But it's the subject of the next four Edgar Cayce readings is about a little dog named Mona. You know, this is not Mona, by the way. I just pulled this off of the internet. Mona must have been some special dog because she had four members of the family. There's a husband, wife, and a niece and a nephew to them. All ask about this dog named Mona. Now, the good news about that, I mean, I like dogs, so it's good news anyway. But the good news is that we also wind up with a deeper understanding of our relationship to our pets because of these four readings that are about to come up. Here's the first one. This is from a Selena Grandy, who is the wife to husband. I don't know what the WBS stands for, but her husband's name was WBS Grandy. All right, so she asked, my little dog, Mona, what was my past life experience with a little dog? And her little dog's name was Mona in this life, and says, in the same experience. In the Roman? The Roman, yes. So in a past life as a Roman, she had had this dog, Mona. Was she a dog then? The answer, a lion. All right, so now we are seeing, are we calling it transmigration? No. Transmigration, in a classic sense from a human standpoint, is when you can go from an animal to a human. This is talking about coming back as a different species of animal. So you're still dealing with the same animal or group soul or group mind. So it's very clear about that, you know, the group mind that was working through the dog was giving the dog this very specific personality. All right, so I'm only guessing here, but I believe it is in the agreement between the group mind and our higher selves that we desire to have a particular interaction with them again. So it's almost like at a higher level we say, hey, group soul of the animal, vegetable, and mineral kingdom, I'd like to have my little Mona back. Yeah, I know she was a lion. I know you can't have a lion in the house in, you know, 1933 here in America, but, you know, do the best you can. Well, Mona came back as a dog. All right, and we're able to have that personality manifesting that was a lion in a dog. Now we get to find out more about Mona. What relation is he to the little dog Mona? He fought with the body in the Roman experience. What was Mona then? The answer, the lioness that fought with the entity and with those that destroyed many that the entity was then seeking to aid. Interesting, isn't it? So Mr. Grandy, I assume, was a soldier and had a lioness for a pet who worked to defeat and then rebuild the neighboring people's homes, whoever they had defeated. And having been a lioness once who protected Mr. Grandy back in the Roman experience, can you imagine running into this little dog again who has these protective instincts and was a lioness? I don't care if the dog's 10 pounds. You've run into those dogs. They're like, I am protecting everybody here. I don't care that I'm 10 pounds. I still feel like I am a lioness. And I could just see that coming through. I just bet Mona was a handful to deal with, I got to tell you. All right, there's still two more on this, though. So here's one. In this case, it was a niece of the Grandies, and it says, when I, in the brackets, I inserted it to try to give context here. When was Selena, the aunt, with the dog Mona? And the answer was in Rome. So she was also part of that incarnation when the Grandies were together then. So was the little dog with me during my lifetime in Jamestown? So apparently no, Mona was not a manifestation of any kind of the pets that she had in a Jamestown incarnation. So the answer was, will Mona always be a dog? Answer, that depends upon the environment and the surroundings. And the answer is no. Mona will not always be a dog. We already know she's a lioness, right? And I always already talked about the fact that the lioness came back as a dog because of the environment and the surroundings that existed in 1933 when they wanted this specific personality to be a part of their family. All right, so it becomes a lot clearer as far as what's appropriate at that particular point. But depending on when it was in history, that could be a cat or a dog or a lioness. And then finally, we have the nephew, Maurice Jones, is, could a life reading be obtained through these sources for my aunt's little dog, Mona? Maybe. As to what it may be is different. It may not be understood unless you learn dog language. All right, so the reading indicates here that Mona didn't need the same kind of guidance that Mr. Jones needed here, or requested from Edgar Cayce. Obviously, he's not sinning. He's doing the right thing, if you will. But certainly, even in the wrong things that Mona might have done and being a little terror and going after people was a learned behavior. So perhaps if we could understand a dog's language, we'd hear guidance that explains what a dog would consider very unusual behavior. I know my dogs have that wondering about us. Stephanie would go to the grocery store, we bring food home and put it up on the counters, and then we put it away. And they look at you like, you're just gonna let all that food sit there? Why aren't we eating all of that? And so dogs have a very different perspective than what we do at this point. Okay, picking up with angels. Now, I think you heard me say earlier, I wasn't able to gather very many images of angels from Google Images, not because there weren't plenty of them to choose from, but because the majority were almost pornographic in nature. This is one of the few that weren't. So if you'll excuse the lack of angel images, and you think I would have so many of them. I would have, by the way, had more cat pictures back in the pet section, but nobody was asking about their cats. In the Cayce readings, it was always about dogs or other animals. Anyway, starting off with a 262 reading from the A Search for God readings to talk about angels. This is a very interesting one. And the way you pronounce this is Hallelujah. I know you look at that and go, what is that word? That is an angel called Hallelujah. So let me read the reading. I'll go into the backstory. In accepting the teacher, Hallelujah, or help promised from Hallelujah, is there any reason to believe we shall not receive the highest and be guided by Spirit of Truth as manifested through the Christ? Answer, it has been given. So it's why I got in the brackets what the previous answer was. Why seek other counsel than the Christ? Was the answer that was given before in a nutshell. So the next question is this, as in seeking Hallelujah's guidance, an opportunity for expanding spiritually, the acceptance of the help promised? Answer, an opportunity for experiencing the presence of the Christ in thine own life is ever before thee. An opportunity rather that ye guide thyself first, then counsel others. But he that would impel shall indeed be impelled. It is interesting. Now, I'll give you a little background on this. On occasion, the Cayce readings, he would actually do what I would call channeling, which is where he steps aside and somebody else comes in. Cayce was an interesting psychic. Unlike channelers, he did what they call doing his own legwork. If he was going to give a health reading for somebody else, he described it as in his higher self went and talked to the higher self of the soul that was seeking healing. Because who's going to know more about what's going on with that body than the soul that's actually going through all this, right? So he would get the information directly from the horse's mouth. Uh-huh. All right. When he was looking for spiritual information or information about past lives, he made access of the Akashic records. And so he would actually go to, if he were to describe it, he would say, I would be shown in these giant books sections that were pertinent to the questions that were being asked. And I would simply read what was sitting in the Akashic record that applied to the question that was there. I wasn't looking at anything else, just those sections that came up like that. Okay? So in Hallelujah's case, he suddenly, Cayce starts speaking and channeling this very high-ranking angel by the name of Philaleel, who promised to be able to do an awful lot of good for the group and to be able to give them great guidance. So their questions are, wow, you have this great, you know, teacher that's coming through Cayce and says he wants to do all this for us. Why wouldn't we listen to him? Well, one of the things I like to say is if you're sitting there and you are feeling like you need guidance, say you're a teenager and you haven't figured out what you want to do with your life yet, and you have before you Mother Teresa, and Mother Teresa is trying to guide you and encourage you and to support you in any way that she can in order for you to become the best you can be. And over here you have General George Patton ready to put you through basic training. Has just as good an intention of trying to straighten your butt out. But he has a little different approach other than Mother Teresa would have in order to be able to do that. Now, you tell me that there aren't some people that would do better with General George Patton than they would with Mother Teresa's kind, supportive, gentle approach. All right, some people do better going through basic training and others do not. I have another quote in here that describes Philaleel as one who would make the way difficult, but for the greater understanding. It's kind of a paraphrase, but it gives you an idea of what's going on with Philaleel as more of the General George Patton out there, as opposed to the very gentle, quiet, you know, Christ consciousness that says, here's my suggestion, you know, pick up your cross and follow me if you like it. Okay, so that's really where we're coming from on Philaleel's side. Now, interestingly enough, Cayce was going through some very bad times when the Philaleel angel started to speak through him. And I'm wondering if it wasn't the tumultuous emotions and all of the problems that he was going through at the time that sent out a vibration that attracted that angel to him to be able to speak through him. It says, here's somebody that could use some basic training to be able to straighten yourself out. And so that angel would come through and says, do you all want me to be able to, to counsel you through this, or do you want to continue on with the Christ? And that's really what most of that came down to. So Philaleel, even in the readings, was described as a high ranking, very much of a leading angel, but one that would make the way difficult. And so, you know, you have to figure out which one of these approaches is the best. But let's face it, if you have to seek counsel, do you think you're going to get better information from Philaleel or from the Christ? Philaleel's not saying, listen to me instead of the Christ. Philaleel's going, I'm here if you need basic training instead of a gentler approach. That's it. So they're not in competition. They're not even in conflict with each other. It's up for the individuals to be able to choose. Fascinating subject in terms of angels. All right, so here are the other two angel images that were not pornographic. And notice one of them's not even, well, it is a gift. I got a twinkling star and a little flying bird over there, all right? So there are all kinds or types of angels. The list over here, there are 9 basic categories. They call them choirs. So 9 basic categories or choirs of angels are shown over here. And the type is too small to read, thank God, because you don't want me to go through all that. This is like that 49 different dimensions. It doesn't really matter if you're having trouble trying to figure out how to treat your neighbor right. All right, there's so many more things to concentrate on in life. But I did want it to be clear that there are all kinds of hierarchies and divisions of angels. And believe me, there aren't just 9. Within the 9, there's a bunch more when you go through all of this. Basically, if you have a need, there is an angel that's in charge of it. All right, so in this reading, what we're going to do, talk about the different types of angels from a Cayce perspective. Explain enlisting the aid of the angels and its spiritual and material significance to these particular entities. Now, this is a person that was looking for healing, I believe, but they were asking about using angels in order to be able to facilitate the healing. So the answer, every experience is as an assurance. And as he has given, behold, the face of the angel ever stands before the throne of God. The awareness in self that thou may be one with, equal with, the Father God as his child, as the brother of the Christ, thy Savior, thy brother. And as the awareness comes, it is the angel of hope, the angel of announcing, the angel of declaiming, the angel that would warn, the angel that would protect. For these are ever as awarenesses, as consciousness of the abiding presence of that he hath given his angels charge concerning thee, by that very desire that, Lord, thy will be done in me today. Bring this up because the person asking for the reading was a Riley Simmons. I don't know if you know American history well enough. I did not. But apparently past life was given to him that he was a General Israel Putnam who was instrumental in winning the, starts with a B, Bunker Hill, winning the Battle of Bunker Hill. So he's a major general in the success of that particular campaign, if you wanted to look him up. So the, but that aside, we start to get an idea of the awareness that comes from the angel of hope, of announcing, the angel declaiming, the angels that would warn and protect. I mean, look at all the different types of angels. Remember what I said? If you have a need, God made an angel for it. So there it is to be able to point that out. It helps me to think of angels like being a software program with artificial intelligence. I mean that. When you go out there and you say, it's programmed to do a particular thing, and it says what a number of those things are right there. But imagine it has an artificial intelligence to it that can only make positive, loving choices. Not negative ones, not the ones that go against what God would choose like we can. But angels can only make positive choices, loving choices that also fulfill what they were designed or programmed in order to be able to do. So if you think of them as being software programs with artificial intelligence, so they're programmed to do, you know, the various things you see up there, and they even have the free will to make those choices in harmony with God, the one thing we have to do ourselves is to be open to receiving their help. I had an experience one time. I was listening to a tape that had to do with angels, and I had this very strange illness, and it had been going on for more than a year. I had a salivary duct along my cheek right here. I don't know if you know it, but you have a duct here that actually puts some saliva into your system, and it had been clogged up with, you know, some kind of a plug in there. And so, when I'd start to eat, it almost hurt, and it would actually swell up because the saliva couldn't get into my mouth. And I was just driving along in the car, and I was listening to this recording that a woman was giving on angels, and it said, if you would but open your mind to the help that angels can give you, you would be surprised at the changes that it could make in your life. Do you know at that very moment, that plug let loose, and just all of a sudden, I felt the rush of saliva go into my mouth, and I even reached in, and I pulled out the plug. I used to save that, but nobody seemed to want to see it. Nah, we'll take your word for it. So I did get rid of that. But the story still stands. I wasn't even sitting there in meditation or anything else. I was just listening to this tape, and I'm going, I wonder if I should do that. Goosh! And it just went like that. I went, huh, I think I'm going to pay some attention to angels now. So I do believe that there is an angel in existence for every need that we have. Now, here's an interesting, mind you, there are no wires or anything. This is a video camera right here. And what you're seeing right there is a camera operator who has a gyroscope. Have you heard about these motion, the dampeners that are right there? So he's able to do all of that motion in the back. And yet, as you're looking at this thing, see how it's relatively stationary, no matter how much of the action he's giving in the back. Now, why am I showing this particular picture? I think it's a great example of what it looks like when a free will entity is behind what a soul would do. I mean, I'd say an angel up here in the front, here's this free will entity that's just going crazy in the back, making this and that and the other decision, and he's just continuing the same old march right there, in love, in compassion, with patience, in cooperation with everything else that's going on out there. So that what I think is also interesting, I've heard psychics that would describe that we can choose, and even talk to one person in particular, it actually made the choice to, conform their choices to that of an angel. They wanted to see what the experience was like to be like an angel and said, I want to be conformed to the choices of an angel, not forever, but just to experience it. And so he got to say, you don't get to do that. That's not exactly right. You need to improve your attitude here, or no, watch out for doing this. Don't have, vengeance in mind. All of these things that would he's trying to do all this, but making everything come out of the choices that he manifests being just like that camera there in the front. So we can actually choose to align our choices with those of an angel so that we may want to sin, but we will see when that would come up if we will allow ourselves so to do it that way. So in such a case, I imagine it looked very much like this cameraman in the picture in the back going crazy while it stays on cue there in the front. Now, this is a relatively new concept for me that I have talked about in the past, but I finally have a graphic that makes a little more sense of it. So when it comes to free will and sin, there is an interesting thing that comes up in the Cayce readings that this helps to explain. A question was asked of Cayce that says, how far away is the vilest act of humankind from the unconditional love of God? So you're thinking, here's the unconditional love of God, and somewhere down here is the most vile act that humankind has ever made. There's going to be a huge gap in there, right? Cayce's answer was fascinating. He said, just under. Here's the unconditional love of God. The vilest act of humankind is just under. Well, guess what? Every act that we have had that was not in line with the unconditional love of God falls just under. Now, I was meditating on this one time, and I was trying to get an answer to this because it sure didn't make any sense to me. I think getting a speeding ticket or cheating on your taxes is not like murdering someone. You know, we tend to get hung up on that, and you're going, if all of these things are just as awful as all the other ones, how can we say that? Well, I got the image of a math test. And I was at a faraway point, and I came in, and I saw some of them had the right answer, and some of them were just checked wrong as you went in. Now, when you see this, okay, you say 2 plus 2 equals 4, 2 plus 2 equals 5 equals 6 equals 7. Which one of those is right and which one is wrong? Pretty easy to answer. But is this one more wrong than this one? From a math teacher's perspective, are they going to give you more credit for this one than they do for this one? Or does this one get more credit than these other two? No. And so when you look at it from that perspective, you go, it's very digital with God. You are either right on it. You've nailed it. You are absolutely perfectly in line with God's loving, harmonious ways, or you are not. So it falls just under. Now, I think when you don't get it right, that we often get messed up with going, well, I'm better than this person, and I'm better than these two. Here, we start to compare ourselves with other people and say, you know what? I'm doing okay because look at how close I am compared to the other two. And God's going, seriously? Why are you so hung up on that? You know, why are you comparing yourself over here? Now, the reason that you see these labels in the top is I think this is very much in line with what the Cayce readings say about our free will, in that we need to set a perfect ideal. And that perfect ideal is always over here. You don't say, I want to have a nicer car than this person, or a nicer car even than this person over here. You just get away from all of the things that comparing yourself from one person to another with your various sins, and keep your eye on the ideal. And that is exactly how you are able to move forward as a free-willed individual. Now, of course, angels don't have so much of that problem, especially when you're up there in the ranks of Gabriel and Michael and Hallelujah, etc. So now we're coming back into understanding more about what angels are all about. We're dealing with a person by the name of Edward Wood here, and wanting to be healed and working with angels on that. So the question is about guardian angels, and is the guardian angel a healing force for physical betterment? The guardian angel, that is the companion of each soul as it enters into the material experience, is ever an influence for the keeping of that attunement between the creative energies or forces of the soul entity and health, life, light, and immortality. This, to be sure, is a portion of that influence for healing forces. And then it jumps down. Do these things then, as we find, as indicated. So all this therapies that he gave in the reading. And we will bring to the physical forces a better cooperation and coordination, and thus through the mental application of the at-one-ment with the creative forces, better reactions in every manner. Now, the in terms of healing, it's letting you know that even a guardian angel can facilitate with healing. But what it is a guardian angel, if you've heard of it, it is a companion that is with each soul as it enters into a material experience. So in other words, if we hang out with God and we never go into manifestation, you don't need a guardian angel because you're one with God, right? But if you go into manifestation, the guardian angel goes with you and is the angel, the good angel on the one shoulder and the bad one on the other, you know how they always show in the cartoons. Your guardian angel is the one that stays with you and makes sure that you, each one of us as the prodigal son, is able to return to God. So the Cayce reading confirms that every soul in the manifest universe anyway has been assigned a guardian angel. And it doesn't mean that we don't have all the other angels available to us. But it's also that you can see even the guardian angel as being one of those very helpful and hopeful programs or applications like computers have, you know, on your smartphone. You have to be able to invoke, if you want, or punch up that application on your smartphone in order for it to help you. I needed to be able to open my mind to the goodness that angels could give me in order to be able to facilitate that healing in the salivary gland. So I think it's very important to keep in mind that these exist. Again, this is the nine choirs of the angels. Showing there, you can read them a little better over there, but want to be able to give you an idea. Do you know how you can tell when somebody is an angel and when they're not when you read them? Their last name ends with E-L. It's interesting to look at that. So when you, here's an interesting one. Lucifer. Does it end with an E-L? No. Do we think Lucifer is an angel? Christians in a traditional sense do. Cayce says no, Lucifer is a soul just like the rest of us. All right, winds up being the poster boy. Now, remember, if angels are all making perfect decisions all the time and souls are making perfect decisions all the time and don't make negative decisions, how do you tell the difference between them? You don't. No wonder somebody could think that Lucifer, up until the point where he sinned, was an angel. You could make that mistake very easily from the point that he's saying, so, wow, look, an angel just sinned. No, a soul with free will sinned. And so we're going to go on to another interesting reading for that. Who is Hallelujah? In the brackets, I'm making it clear. He, Hallelujah, is a messenger of the Most High. Hallelujah is the one who from the beginning has been a leader of the heavenly host, who has defied Ariel, who has made the ways that have been heavy, but as the means for the understanding. Remember what I was saying? Hallelujah is one who makes the way difficult, but it helps some people to go through basic training to gain the greater understanding. Let's go on to another second paragraph down from there. Who is Hallelujah? The one who gave us a message on October 15th. Oh, I'm sorry. This is a whole different reading altogether. This is the work readings at 254, and this is a search for God reading. So who is Hallelujah? The one who gave us the message on October 15th. One in and with those courts, Ariel fought when there was the rebellion in heaven. Now, where is heaven? Where is Ariel? And who was he? A companion of Lucifer or Satan, and one that made for the disputing of the influences in the experiences of Adam in the garden. Okay, so in looking at this, we find out that we have an angel who was a companion of Lucifer. So if we had a companion of Lucifer, we're talking about an angel that actually started making poor choices out there. Now, was the angel doing it in defiance of God, or was the angel so focused on helping Lucifer do what Lucifer does that it's kind of like the pit bull that'll go and jump into a ring because its master told it to because he wants to be able to please the master? I do think in the case of Ariel, that's exactly what happened. Became so focused on being able to please the master, or you will, Lucifer in that case, that Ariel would wind up doing things that were out of harmony with God's loving ways. But I don't think it's very difficult for Ariel, once he has his focus off of, in fact, Ariel's considered a very high angel today, but is all of a sudden not focused on Lucifer going, oh, that's wrong, and knew that that Ariel needed to make better choices from there. It could do so immediately once they got their balance back together. All right, so I think that's an interesting, that's why I bring it up. And you can go out there and say, wow, an angel even up at a higher level can wind up being having a problem. Finally, we go to things like fairies and gnomes and elementals. So you have, fairies, or you have pixies, or you have leprechauns, and so on. I don't have all of the things represented right there, but there were certainly more than 9 varieties of little people. I think my next slide here. Can you read those? Fairies, pixies, sprites, brownies, nixies, gnomes, nature spirits, kobolds. I don't even know what that is. What is that? Duins, goblins, wee folk, elves, fauns, trolls, the fates, and so on. Then it comes on, however, mermaids, mermen, centaurs, satyrs, sirens, harpies, and others of this kind are not of the little people. Sorry, that's as good as I could get that slide to come out. I actually got that from a talk one time from John Van Auken, if you're familiar with him. He's one of the better known authors and speakers for the ARE. So the the little people, if you will, have various manifestations, or are various manifestations of group mind. There, as you can see from all of the depictions that history has, they're partially human, partially animal beings, if you fall below this line right here. And those are really not part of the good group up here, or that group mind, that have nothing but helpful and hopeful intent behind them. When you start seeing that there's partial human, partial animal, as you have with the mermaid, merman, centaur, satyrs, and so on, that's where you wind up understanding that those were creations from free-willed souls. And they could even have a soul entrapped within that physical body to have created it. So those perversions of the animal form that were intended to live on the earth have human features about them is really what gets rid of the two. The one thing, do you know that angel pictures that were drawn going back in history didn't have wings? And then as you move forward in history, suddenly angels started to have wings. It was that humanity's need for a scientific mind going, how can an angel fly without wings? Now, of course, that makes no sense to us, but I think that's where the evolution came from, that at first angels were just these magnificent beings, and then they wound up having wings on them later on. Okay, so we have our gnomes here. It is not that the little people actually have bodies like in the case of gnomes that are pictured here. Their appearance, as I understand it, is a reflection of how they want us to perceive them. I don't know if you know that, but even with humans, you know, if you have people that encounter somebody on the other side and you go, well, I ran into my mother, but she looked like she was, 30 or 40 years old, not 80 or 90 when she died. This is how they want to appear to you. They aren't that person anymore, but how are they going to, I want you to remember who I am, as in, yes, I was your parent, but I am this young, vibrant, healthy, individual that is out there. And so the perception that they want you to have in the case of these little people, if you will, is a kindly, loving, cute, non-threatening and whatsoever, only trying to have fun and still wanting to be helpful and hopeful, right? So their appearance is a reflection of how they want us to see them. And they would be just as wonderful as you can imagine them. But there are also ethereal entities that have selfish intent. You can consider those things like, demons and so forth. Now, what is a demon? A demon, to me, is not actually a soul. It's not even a group mind. What it winds up being is almost like a virus in a computer. You know, it's somebody will come along, a free will being will create a virus for a computer and go out there and infect everybody, and they'll go, ha ha, look what I did. And there was no good intention behind it whatsoever. But did the program itself make a free will decision to do that? And the answer is no. It was just a creation from a free will being to go out there and wreak havoc. So when you hear of evil little things out there and demons and so on, they were thought forms created by souls who had a free will to act with, and create something that God would not. But they do not come from God, and they certainly, anything they do It's not in God's in accord with or harmony with God's loving ways is not coming from the little people side of the world. So we're going to get a few readings here of people. There's just a few more and then we're done. Don't be afraid to acknowledge that ye see fairies as ye study, for you will nurture these experiences. Don't be afraid to say that you see the gnomes, which would hinder people at times. These may be a part of the background for many of the cards, for many of the various sketches which you would make. Now, this person asking for this reading, Joan Lupton, was an aspiring artist, and she was afraid to use the images that she could actually see in real life of gnomes and of fairies to be able to inspire her to do the greeting card artwork that she was trying to get jobs as an artist for. She was afraid to use that because when you're talking about that would hinder people at times, they're going, gee, do we really want to put, you know, these ethereal kind of beings out there on a card? Is that the right thing? Is it Maxfield Parrish that said, yeah, I really want to do that? He did, if you know who that artist is, where he has all of the fairies and the, you know, just beautiful artwork out there like that. He really made a great living off of that. So, unfortunately, I tried to see if there was any follow-up reports or letters or anything, but there was nothing that suggested whether she actually went through with this or not. But that was the suggestion, was that she would use the images that she saw of fairies, of gnomes on the other side to create greeting cards, and that would be the greater success for her. So, now we have, like, pixies or fairies that are running around here, and again, at least they're not scantily clad vixens, as I kept running into over and over again. But, you know, that always surprised me because I was looking at it going, if you're really talking about this spiritual entity that is only there to be helpful and hopeful to everybody, why would they want to appear as sexually desirable, you know, vixens, you know, that would be operating in conflict with that concept? So where this whole idea, you know, came up, I think, is more for trying to sell magazines than anything else. Just, but it really is more of an innocent interaction between them, and they have no real physical bodies, as I will go into in a minute. In this reading, before this, the entity was in the Scotch land. The entity began its activity as a prodigy, as one already versed in its associations with the unseen or the elemental forces, the fairies, and those of every form that do not give expression in a material way and are only seen by those who are attuned to the infinite. Now, this individual, Horace Poole, did, I don't know, poetry, but he was a famous Scottish poet by the name of Thomas Campbell in a past life. So you can look that one up if you want. But apparently his artistic mind allowed him to attune to the infinite and be able to see the elemental forces, the fairies, and I am going to get into the difference between those. So the implication here is that is to be able to show us how we too might be able to see these people. It requires an attunement of the mind to higher realms than we can see with the human senses. It's kind of like in our hearing, we only hear up to maybe 20,000 hertz with our hearing, but then the eyes can pick up at a much higher vibration and be able to see colors above that. Well, guess what they're talking about? That the mind is able to attune to a vibration even higher than that, which is necessary in order to be able to see the unseen or the fairies and the elemental forces that are out there. So when you attune to the infinite is the way to be able to, not with your eyes, but with your mind, be able to see. I don't know if you've ever had a telepathic experience in which you're able to tell what somebody else is thinking. If you ever go through that, you will understand what this means when you're going, okay, I know I didn't hear that with my ears, but I heard that just as clear as you possibly can. If you've ever been through that, you'll understand this better, but it will come to you just as clearly as the five senses, if not clearer than that. So, I think the bottom line here is, what is our intention in wanting to see these little people? If the things that we see are intended to be shared in ways that are helpful and hopeful to others, then indeed we will see them. But if we are trying to do something negative with it, or, you know, we have some kind of a selfish intent with wanting to be able to see them, then we won't. That's how you attune your mind to the infinite, is by having the right attitude and emotions involved with it. Now, I chose this picture because it really does reflect my concept of the way we perceive little people, if you will, in three dimensions. Notice that all of heaven and nature is represented, and it's kind of right here where the mind, if you will, is in this particular picture. It's located in the human body anyway. However, the face of this particular entity, if you will, is shown to the universe, so it's showing out all of this infinity and all this beauty in the back, captures the beauty and essence while it's still being recognizable as a relatable and friendly being to us humans. You see what I'm getting at? There's just this infinite beauty going on back here in all parts of nature, in the animal, vegetable, and mineral kingdom, but the face that it shows the rest of this universe is one that's very relatable to us. I think this is why we see fairies and gnomes and brownies and pixies and all the rest of that as being such a relatable, such cute, such wonderful little beings out there, because that's what they intend us to see. There's no reason why they would come off as being anything else. And if they were to come off looking something like this, you go, what the heck is that? That's not relatable as far as what we are used to seeing. So they meet us where we are here in the three dimensions. Now, interesting that this has to do with the Edgar Cayce's oil field readings. There was a four-year period in the 20s that that Cayce was using his abilities to try to find oil in a number of different states, mainly in Texas. So this is one of the people that was on his team that was helping him with that. Could Helena Martin of New York City or Moon Trail, through the medium HS Hambling of London, and supply further helpful ideas concerning the development of the oil field properties? Answer. Rather, had the entity best listen to the voices from within that present themselves as the activities about the entity or brownies. Now, that's not the Girl Scout, Little Girl Scouts. Brownies are like pixies and all that. It's interesting that he comes out and says the entities that have to do with finding oil underneath the ground would have to do with the brownies. And you hear about that there are fairies that are in charge of lakes and trees and mountains and all that, but it seems like brownies are more, you know, earthly, if you will, in the things that they are in charge of. So, you know, Edgar Davis was a part of that team that was working with Cayce to try to be able to find oil that would fund his work for the rest of his life. It's a long story, but he never did strike oil. And went home feeling like a failure. But however, when he went home, that was when Morton Blumenthal gave him the money to be able to build the hospital that kind of was helping him fulfill his life's work. And then the Great Depression came along and that fell apart. And but even at that point, they wound up having the home that the ARE sits in today to be able to carry his work on in the future. So as one door closes, another one opens. So you just can't help it if you go about this stuff with the right attitude. It's still also with Edgar Davis trying to go, what in the heck is a brownie, right? He says, what is meant by the term brownies in the last answer of the check reading? Answer, the manner in which those of the elementals, entities, who have not entered into materiality have manifested and do at times manifest themselves before or to the entity. 1265 being this Edgar Davis. Brownies, pixies, fairies, gnomes are not elementals, but elements that are as defined entities as man materialized. So in other words, what we're saying is, I think it's more like that group of angels that has a manifestation not of having the, you know, this magnificent countenance, if you will, but it comes across as being these cute, wonderful little playthings. In fact, I hear most stories I hear of kids playing with them. That was when Edgar, even though he could see them all of his life, he saw these little people, if you will, and played with them often as a child. So we really come to the difference between elementals and little people. In my opinion, and it's hard to discern it from this, elementals are more of a concept than they are of a being. It's like there's a difference between, you know, the difference between a computer program that performs a particular function and having that same computer program that has artificial intelligence to go along with it. So you say, here's how it's going to happen, and that would be an elemental. But if you go, and I'm going to give you a mind to be able to say, hey, there's two options here, and this is the better one, it has the artificial intelligence to choose the better option instead of the first one that comes to them. So it's as close as I can come to being able to describe the difference between elementals and the entities of the little people. So this is getting almost to the end, so Steve will be ready for my little video to close. We have, this is an artist's depiction of air and earth and fire and water right here. So it's trying to give a physical face, putting a face to the entities that we would call the elements or the elementals out here. And now I'm going to go on to the slide that defines what they are. Earth is connected to the north. It's considered the ultimate feminine element. The earth is fertile and stable, associated with the goddess. Now, I'm not going to read each one of these, but we have earth, air, fire, and water described in whether they're part of the north, you know, south, east, and west, and whether they are part of the feminine or masculine energy. So it does cover the basic characteristics on there. And it isn't that all of us are just one thing. For instance, I'm a Virgo with the sun sign, and that's an earth sign. And I have Cancer rising, which is a major influence on my astrology chart, which is a water sign. And I have a moon in Aries, another major consideration of the chart, which is a fire sign. With all of that, I would hope that it means that I come into this life with a greater balance. Otherwise, I'm making a huge mess for my wife to clean up. I'll blame it all on her. So, final reading here, in which we have, much may be found in the records as to the activity of the entity in the name of Connolly, and among those that made for the establishing of the government and the relationships dealing with people. Hence, law will have its effect upon the activities of this entity. Yet, as we find, those things that deal more with the elementals or with the constituents of things rather than people will bring the greater mental and physical development for this entity. This person, you've met folks that say, I'd much rather work in an office on my own than have to deal with the public or with the other people and teams and all that. And because this entity was a person was described as being more interested in things than people, they would respond better to elemental influences that are more like that beehive or the ant farm mentality, rather than being approached by little people that want to have a fun time with a one-on-one relationship. An excellent career application for this kind of a soul would have been, let's say, to design if he wanted to get involved in government, if you will, how about if he designed the layout of Washington, D.C., rather than be involved in the legislature of being able to put the laws together that have people able to interact with each other in harmony. I don't know if you've ever seen Washington, D.C., if you ever hear the planning behind it, is intended to intimidate the hell out of everybody. You go in there and you just feel the power and the way that everything is laid out. There is a lot of psychology behind the way not only just the city is laid out, but even the way rooms and all of that are done within the White House and other buildings. So that would be a much better use for this person, to be able to be involved in the things of the layout rather than try to get into the laws that have interactions with individuals. Okay, so I have a final note here that's going to show how pets can brighten our lives, even when it seems like they might be a hindrance. What you're about to see here is what I call Cayce clips. Instead of these 90-minute or so lectures, Steve winds up doing a Cayce clip that's maybe 5 or 6 minutes long on a particular question. And this one, what you're going to see first is a clip that actually wound up on the air. And then it's going to be followed by a clip that how much better it turns out when you get the help from your own pet at home. In this case, my little dog, Cookie.
Now, to me, this sounds like an incredibly merciful law. That's the law of karma. And it does not fit in well with reaping everything that we've sown. To me, this sounds like the incredibly merciful law of grace doesn't fit well.
Cut. Cookie was not to be denied. By the way, I put that video, it's about 18 seconds long, I put that on the YouTube channel with all the others. More than 300 people have wanted to see Cookie so far. So Cookie's quite popular.
And you just started to talk about grace and
Cookie. And the next thing you know, I've got Cookie right up there. What you couldn't see is I was trying to keep Cookie at bay there for a while as I'm going through this, and then it was too late.
over here. Each one of them has a different look to it, but they're all connected to the same group, mind, or soul. And it's almost, I was talking to Catherine before, saying, if you ran into a person that you knew only in grade school, and another person you knew in junior high, and another one in college, and another one at your job, you would have a different way of interacting with each and every one of those people. But it's because of the way that they are interacting with you, not because you're a different person inside. They're calling to a different part of you. So the animals that we have, and we say that a pet reincarnates with us, it's actually the same group soul that's deciding to interact with you in the same way that they had in a previous life, or in a previous life to themselves, or two previous lives, you and them. Yeah.
So did Cayce ever say, I heard that elementals could be those little small baby angels that we see flying around, some of these wood nymph things and fairies, that they're to lighten our consciousness and bring us into more happier state, you know.
Always, elementals and fairies and little people are always to be helpful, hopeful, encouraging. Every one of them.
And Cayce said that.
Excellent. Yeah. There is no. What I was trying to say is, it's not that you can't find little people out there that are like demons or what was the Mogwai thing? I don't even remember what that, gremlins, that's it. Demons, gremlins, and all that. To me, those are not creations of God. Those are like those thought forms that are created with an evil intent that go like a computer virus on automatic pilot. And they just do what they were created to do. But that's not from God. That's from our free will, just like the monstrosities we could create had God not intended that. Oh, if you were to read a lot of the, especially from that S-E-A-Y, Barbara that was on there, she was Anna in a previous life, Anna C-A, same last name, and she and Cayce were together and would play with the little people together, and there are actual letters of which that's all described. All the time. Yeah, he wasn't always very lighthearted, that's for sure. Well, we are up to 9 o'clock at this point. I'm happy to answer any more questions, but we will wrap up the recording at this point. Thank you.